Greetings, everyone. This is Michael King, and welcome back to B Movie Mania. It's been a while, guys. Yes, I know. But what better way than to open up a new season of the show than to focus on the films of the legendary Roger Corman? Now, Roger Corman is the undisputed king of B Movie motion pictures, and even today, although he's in his 80s, he is still producing motion pictures. As a matter of fact, guys, I happened to catch a trailer of one of Corman's latest films, and that was Dino Croc vs. Super Gator. And I got to tell you, this film looks hilarious. Hilariously entertaining, I might add. But today, guys, we're going to focus on one of Corman's earlier films, actually from 1982. And I actually have the Blu-ray here to show you guys. And before I go into any in-depth talk on the film itself, I'm going to show you what comes with the Blu-ray itself. Now, it's also available in DVD, but the Blu-ray is the one that I opted for. Now, let's take a look. Well, here you go, guys. This is the actual Blu-ray cover art for the film, and this actually is the theatrical poster. It's one of Roger Corman's reach out and grab you. This scene does not appear in the movie posters. But stunning artwork, guys. Really, really amazing art, and it does reach out and grab you. But like I said, this does not appear in the film. And here's the back of the Blu-ray itself, guys. If I can get up close to it. There we go. As you can see, it has a wealth of special features on it. Let's open it up. Snap case there, guys. Now, when you open it up, what you'll see is the theatrical version of the film here, and then this one actually comes with a booklet, which is so rare these days. But yes, it does come with a booklet. When you remove this booklet, you get a director's cut of the film entitled Mutant. Now, Mutant was the original name of the film itself, and the name actually got changed into Forbidden World. Now, we'll go into that a little bit later on. But now, what I will say about Mutant here is that it's the actual director's cut of the film, the first release of the film. It was only seen during screenings, and Roger Corman didn't like the cut of the film, so he had it changed. Now, Mutant is actually on DVD. This is not a Blu-ray. Now, I do have a bit of a beef with the Blu-ray here, guys. Now, if you're buying a film that you perceive to be on Blu-ray, it's in Blu-ray packaging, and there's no outside advertisement alerting you to the fact that there is actually a DVD in the set, then you should not have a DVD in the set. And that's a little beef of mine. I mean, the director's cut of the film is on DVD. They didn't process it to Blu-ray, which is really kind of incredible to me, because Shout Factory usually does such a wonderful job with its presentations that I was kind of surprised that the director's cut, the never-before-seen director's cut of the film, which is actually the actual screener that Corman didn't like, the first time it's ever been seen or put on this media, it's amazing to me that they didn't process it to Blu-ray. The quality isn't all that great, but like I said, we'll go into that a little bit later. So other than that, it's a really great presentation, and the booklet itself, which I'm going to show you now, it's kind of hard to get a good shot of the book itself, given all the glare from the lighting that I use to make these videos. But here's the booklet itself, and here's the back of the booklet where we have some of Corman's other films. And let me tell you guys that this booklet is one of the kind of rare treats that Shout Factory has added with this collection here, where you actually get some making of material on the film. And it's really nice to have, really collectible, which is really nice because you get some insider notes. And it's just a great addition to add to an already well-packaged product here. So I would definitely say thumbs up to the contents of this collection. Now, what's kind of interesting about this film is that it came out in 1982, and 1982 was a big year for film. I remember the release of E.T., Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, John Carpenter's A Thing, Blade Runner. Just a big year for science fiction films. And this film just flew over the radar. I never heard of it. And quite frankly, I don't know why I missed it, other than the fact that it was such a year of big blockbuster sci-fi films that this one could not find an audience. And I don't even think it had a release in Oklahoma. But Forbidden World definitely left its mark to a lot of genre fans. And as a matter of fact, I watched it over the weekend, and that was the theatrical version of the film, the director's cut of the film, and then finally I listened to the director's commentary of the film. And the commentary is actually on the director's cut of the film itself. This film actually can be traced all the way back to 1979, where Roger Corman, a huge fan of Alien, saw the potential to make a film in the vein of Ridley Scott's classic movie and make a lot of money. Now, that was the origin of Forbidden World, or should I call it Mutant? Now, the whole Mutant Forbidden World thing came about because originally when the film was screened, it was entitled Mutant. And the screening itself is quite a tale within itself, but when the film was screened for an audience, the director and Roger Corman were there, and apparently there was a lot of laughter. And Roger Corman was really pissed at this fact. The audience was cracking up, and Corman just grew angrier and angrier. And finally, he stood up to one of the guys that was really laughing, one of the people that had actually participated in the screening. I mean, not a producer or director or anybody like that, but just a regular audience member. And he slapped the audience member across the face and said, "Hey, this is a serious science fiction film. This is horror. You're not supposed to be laughing." And now this is where it goes into a little bit of he said, she said, but from different accounts on the film itself, the producers and the people behind it, it is said that the guy actually threw a Coke at Corman for the slap later on during the screening, but we can't really prove whether or not that's true or not. But we do know that Corman did slap the audience member across the face for laughing at the film. And he was really upset because Corman's the kind of producer who thinks that if you're seeing a horror film, you need to be scared. There's no room for comedy. He believed that it ruined the film. Now, the director had a totally different view. He thought that the audience laughing actually gave the film a much better approval position. But Corman didn't like it. Corman dragged him to the door and said, "Allan, this ain't going to work. This film is being laughed at. They're not supposed to be laughing." And the director's like, "Well, what do you mean? It's going over good. It's a popular film. People like it." "No, this film is not supposed to be funny. This is a horror film, but I know how to fix it." And, you know, Holzman was like, "What do you mean?" "Don't worry. I'm going to edit the film. I can still save it." And of course, you know, the money was Roger Corman, so he had the final say, even though the director was really dismayed at the process because he wanted to keep the humor in. But now, Corman was making a film similar to Alien. As a matter of fact, I'd say that this movie is probably his most similar to Ridley Scott's film Alien, because it does play a lot like Alien. Even the creature itself looks a little bit like the alien creature, the xenomorph. So, you know, the film was displayed under the name Mutant, and, you know, I'm watching the extras on the DVD, and one of the questions presented to Roger Corman is, why was the film title changed? And Corman has no recollection of this. He said he can't remember. It's been so long ago, he doesn't remember why the film was changed. But he said that they did test names, and that he felt that it was probably due to the fact that the name Forbidden World tested more popular than the name Mutant. So, we go to the director during the commentary, and then we go to the name change issue again. And he said that the name was changed because Corman didn't like the name, and that they needed a name that reached out to the audience more. And it was Corman's decision to change the film's name to Forbidden World. And the director, you know, approached him and said, "Well, hey, if we call it Forbidden World, people are going to confuse the film with Forbidden Planet. And Corman said, well, that film was made 20 years ago. Nobody's going to care about that film. That's ancient history. So they kept the name Forbidden World, even though the director didn't agree with that change also. Now, there's director didn't have too good of an experience with this film. You know, he didn't get to make the film that he wanted. And he didn't have creative control enough over Corman. Corman had the final say. I mean, it was his company, and he had the right to do what he wanted to do. But the director definitely was dismayed at this point. Now, this film, Forbidden World, is definitely a cheaply made film, and it shows on screen. And the film even uses sets from one of Roger Corman's earlier films, Galaxy of Terror. Now, these sets were designed by James Cameron. And it's kind of strange, kind of funny actually, when you watch the film on screen and you see them in Cameron's sets and then you see them in some of the other production designer's sets, and it just does not go together well. Cameron's sets, despite the fact that he didn't have a lot of money, look much better than the actual sets created for the film. And when we go into that story, that's an amazing story all in itself. Now, apparently, some of the walls in the film were actually made from McDonald's to-go boxes. And if you look closely, you can see these boxes painted, and you can also see egg cases. Now, not the big cases, the crates the eggs come in, but the little cases that you find in the grocery store, the little packagings you find in the grocery store that, you know, houses the eggs. You can also see those in the background of the film. You see regular pull-out drawers. I mean, everything in this film screams of, we don't have any money. And it's just an incredible mess of production that has Corman's name written all over it. And if you can get past the cheaply made sets and the, I mean, you know, in this film, you have futuristic spaceships, you have galactic laser fights, you have laser weapons, but when you go inside the actual sets themselves, you have a world that is definitely 1982. And it's kind of the charm of the film itself. You know, I watched the film and I was able to, you know, look over these things. It wasn't really that distracting to me because I'm a Roger Corman enthusiast, so I knew what to expect. But if, you know, if you're jumping into a Roger Corman film for the first time and you see this brilliant cover and you see this creature and this beautiful woman, and then you go into the film and you see the production design, you might be a little bit jarred or floored. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about the film itself, guys. Now, you know me, I will not include any spoilers. I hate ruining a film, especially for a movie that you probably have never seen. Now, the film begins on the planet Exorbia. And on this planet, we have a scientific research team from the planet Earth. They've created something called Subject 20. Now, apparently Subject 20 is a new life form that is supposed to aid in ending hunger. Now, the film never presents us with the planet Earth. We don't know how severe the crisis is as far as starvation is concerned. We don't really learn anything outside Exorbia itself, which is kind of strange, but we don't. Now, apparently the life form has gotten out of hand. It's killed all the research animals, and the government, which in this film is called the Federation, sends a problem solver to the planet to take charge and, in his mind, decide what action needs to be taken. So he goes in and he decides that, from the evidence that he's seen, decides that this thing needs to be killed. Now, a problem arises, guys, in the story where you have the person sent to take charge of the situation. He wants to kill the creature, but the lead scientist of the research facility does not. So that creates a conflict, but little known to all of them, this creature is mutating, growing larger, and becoming a more deadly carnivore, with them in mind for food. And there you have it, guys. That's the basic plot of the story. A group of humans trying to survive against an unstoppable creature. Now, it's really uncanny how much this film is like Alien itself. I mean, you even have, in kind of a larval stage, a bit of the creature that attaches itself to the face of one of the characters, a la Facehugger. And the creature design itself, as I said, the head design looks quite a bit like the alien creature from Alien. And just a lot of the setup of the story, that's not to say, guys, that there aren't differences in the story, because obviously there are differences or this film would have not gotten made. But it's just uncanny how closely this film resembles Alien. And one of the production people was approached and told by another staff member that this is just a sleazy ripoff of Alien. And the staff member's reply was, yeah, but it's the best damn sleazy ripoff of Alien. So with that in mind, guys, now we have the basic Corman elements in the story, aside from the cheap elements of the story, but we have two very beautiful women in the film that are just nude throughout much of the film. And you can just tell that the nudity is just thrown in as eye candy. And that's probably pretty much as to why this film has achieved such a cult following. The nudity, which is pretty surprising considering it was 1982. I mean, you actually see pubic hair. You see asses. I mean, you pretty much get it all in this film. Now, granted, there's not any close-ups, but you do see a large amount of nudity in this film. And it's very welcome. I mean, the girls look good and their bodies look good. But let me say also, guys, that just the way the nudity is put into film, it's just gratuitous. I mean, you have a bounty hunter who just arrives on the station not 10 minutes into the story, and he's assigned to his sleeping quarters, and one of the girls just says, I hear you're the best at what you do, and she drags him into his room and they have sex. And she barely even knows the guy's first name. And we have this long, gratuitous sex scene that, you know, I'm a veteran film watcher here, guys. So, you know it's kind of just unnecessary, but it is thrown in. Now, oftentimes, guys, there's just a lot of silliness in the screenplay. I mean, you have a creature, a deadly creature, that has just escaped quarantine. But at the same time, you have one of the girls going down to the sauna room, getting naked, and, you know, just chilling out. And I mean, you wouldn't have to tell me twice, you know, something's escaped. I'm standing in my freaking room. But you just have a lot of elements added to the story that just, quite frankly, people in real life wouldn't do. You have a head scientist just bitching all the time about, oh, this is a clean-free zone. No, this is a germ-free zone. But at the same time, you have a head doctor, his co-worker, who is just coughing and gagging and just smoking throughout the entire film, and nothing's ever said. And as a matter of fact, nothing's even said about, are you okay? You know, I mean, it's a silly film. It definitely, just, the screenplay is just oftentimes very silly and unintentionally funny. But overall, it's really entertaining. It has a short running time, I believe like 85 minutes. And everything goes on at a brisk nature. And every now and then you get a shot on film that actually looks pretty damn good. You get, now this film doesn't have really any special effects at all, not at least not very many optical effects, but the ones that you do get aren't bad at all. Some of the planet side scenes where you see the research station on the planet actually looks kind of decent. But there are some really curious things in the film, like the film opens up with a space battle that was lifted, taken from Battle Beyond the Stars, where you see the bounty hunter, which basically, I guess he's a bounty hunter, or maybe he's not a bounty hunter, maybe he's a Federation worker. The Federation is the name of the government in this film, the Federation. Now, at the very beginning of the film, he's asleep, and they give you this flashback of scenes showing everything that happens in the film really fast, and I'm thinking, why? Why would you show the viewer what's going to happen later on in the film in flashbacks? I mean, granted, they are real fast, but you do see flashbacks within the film, and I'm thinking, I don't think I would have done that. But he's awakened by a robot in the film, and he has to do battle with this, they never tell, other than he being attacked by these alien ships. They never tell why they're attacking, what they're doing, what they want. Apparently they're trying to kill him. And I don't know if he went up against them in the past, and maybe disgrace them, destroy some of their spaceships or whatever. But we have this totally unnecessary scene at the beginning that is all stock footage from Battle Beyond the Stars that really has nothing to do with the story. It just seemed like to me an indulgence of the director to put that in. Now, I understand why that was put in there, because Corman, before Allan Holzman got the job, Corman said, let's see what you can do in a day. And he kind of put together this reel of film showing the actor and the space scene and the stock footage and all that. And, you know, Corman probably thought, wow, he used stock footage. That was cheap. Brilliant, man, brilliant. So he got the job. But anyway, despite that guy, despite his shortcomings, this is not Corman's best film, but it's definitely not his worst. An enjoyable film, just campy and fun, totally unrealistic, and just a gem of a film. Definitely in the vein of the 80s. I'd say check it out. Now, like I said before, guys, Corman's films are definitely not for everybody. So, you know, you might go into this not liking it. But it's like the director was saying to himself, you know, if people aren't going to like this story, this film, I'll throw in a little bit of nudity. And the nudity does look good. Now, as far as the transfer goes, guys, this is one of Corman's low-budget films. Wow, that's an oxymoron. This is filmed very cheaply with cheap equipment, cameras, and all that. So the Blu-ray transfer of the film isn't all too great. You see quite a bit of film grain. But in heavy light scenes, where there's a lot of light in the scenes, heavy lit scenes, the film looks pretty good for one of Roger Corman's movies. So it's a decent transfer, but sometimes it doesn't look any better than a very good VHS quality film. As far as the director's cut of the film, which is on DVD, it's kind of like almost a work print. It looks like a bad VHS copy, but it is definitely watchable, and the commentary is definitely very, very well done. So I'd say, guys, definitely check out Forbidden World. If you're not into Blu-rays, I definitely say don't sink your money into a Blu-ray. Get the DVD version just for sheer money saving. But overall, not a bad film. Entertaining. Definitely not going to leave you with any deep afterthoughts or or anything like that. But it is a quirky, silly sci-fi film that has Roger Corman's name all over it, and quite entertaining at times. And I, on a positive note, guys, I will say that the gore and makeup effects are very well done. And what's really kind of nice about this is when you watch the special features, you have makeup artists here and special effects guys who take just as much pride in their work as the people at ILM would take in their work. Even though they didn't have the money to do what they wanted to do, which one of the guys actually says, and it's frustrating to him, they did the best they could on the limited budget. So, you know, it's nice to know that people, you know, care about the product even though they don't have the money to actually do what they want to do. So they just do the best they could. So check it out, guys. Forbidden World, definitely not one of Corman's worst and not one of his best. Check it out. Until next time, guys, we'll see you. And the next film will be another Corman classic. Forbidden World, guys. Take a look.